Okay, so today's class is on enthalpy. So first, let me just quickly remind you, how did we define enthalpy? We defined enthalpy as H equal to U plus PV. This was obtained from the Legendre transformation of du equal to minus PdV plus TdS. So this was the initial small differential change in the internal energy, and from this Legendre transformation we defined this u plus as u plus p. Okay, so this is how we defined enthalpy, right? I hope everybody is with me till this point. So this is how we defined enthalpy. Now we want to understand, what does it mean physically? So to understand actually what does it mean physically, we have to actually go and study something called Joule-Thomson expansion. We have to study actually this. So, yes. So let's start studying Joule-Thomson expansion, as always. Yes, so let's start studying Joule-Thomson expansion. Okay, so what is Joule-Thomson expansion? You have an thermally isolated cylinder. So this is a cylinder which is thermally isolated from the rest of the world. So this is how we define the walls which are thermally isolated. This is how we draw them in. If you find walls drawn like this in thermodynamics, you understand that they are thermally isolated. So you cannot give any heat from it. It does not absorb any heat from the outside, and it does not release any heat from the inside. And in that cylinder, so this is just the cross-sectional of the cylinder. So cylinder is like this. Cylinder is like this. And you are watching it from this side. So if you just take a cross-section and cut it down on this line. So if this is a cylinder, you are cutting it like this, slicing it like this, and putting it horizontally, and then slicing it like this. You are seeing it from the side. So this is the cross-sectional view of the cylinder. In that cylinder, there are two pistons. So this is one piston. Pistons are also cylindrical in nature. I hope you know how these pistons work. So they are something like this. These are the pistons. Actually, these are the pistons. So they are round. They are cylindrical in shape, and they just fix themselves so that no gas can escape from these walls. And these pistons are also thermally isolated. So they are called adiabatic pistons, which means that they are not letting any mass flow outside, and they are not even letting any temperature or heat interaction from the system to the surrounding. So they are not letting it happen. So there is no heat interaction, and there is no mass interaction. So there are no particles going from the cylinder to the outside, and no particles coming from the outside inside the cylinder. So this is piston number one. Then you have something called a plug. Which is porous plug. So you draw the porous plug in thermodynamics like this. What do you mean by porous plug? It means it is something like a wall. It is a wall, but it has small holes in it. So some small holes are there. So with the help of those holes, a gas or any fluid in this section can go to the other section. So this is the porous plug. And in this section as well, there is a cylinder which is adiabatic. So it will not let any particles from the outside, and it will not let even the heat transfer. So this piston is exactly pressed onto this porous plug. So there is no gas here. But in this section, there are some gas molecules at pressure Pi. In this section, there are some gas molecules at pressure Pi in the volume Vi. So in this section, there is some gas. And in between, there is a porous plug. So you draw it by this straight line, because it allows the gas particles to go from one part to the other part, and this is the other part of the piston. Okay, so has anybody of you seen this porous plug? You must have seen this porous plug in your spray bottle. So if you have the spray can, this deodorant you use, or any spray can, if you use it to paint those graffitis on the wall, those spray cans are having these kind of porous walls. So if you have a spray bottle like this, in this part. In the nozzle, this part is known as the porous plug. So if you press this, then only the gas comes out from this. Otherwise, it stays inside. So this plug is also known as porous plug. Small hole in the big wall. So this is also good example of a porous plug. You have seen these kind of porous plugs in your life. And let's not draw these diagrams in your permanent notes, but this is the starting point of the experiment. This is the porous plug. And this is the starting point of your experiment. So let us write what everything is. So the system is thermally isolated. Now, the pistons are adiabatic. And plug is porous. This is known as plug, which is porous plug. Plug is a porous plug. So it means you can shift mass from it to there. So this is porous plug. Now, the process which is known as Joule-Thomson expansion. What is an expansion? It means the gas from one side will go to the other side. That is the expansion of gas. So how do we do that? We do it. This state is an equilibrium state. So you have a gas at some specific pressure, some specific volume. And now what you do is you just move these both of these pistons at different velocities. So you move this piston with velocity V1, suppose. You press this piston with velocity V2, suppose. So that the pressure in this region remains PI for the whole process. And the pressure in this region where the gas will come because of the porous plug. Now, if you move this piston, the gas will come from this section to this section. And in the pressure in that rightward section is PF always. You want to maintain both of these pressures. So you have to actually move these pistons at different velocities. That is what you actually want to do. So we are moving these both of these pistons with different velocities so that the initially the equilibrium state is PIVI, but the final equilibrium state becomes something like this. So this is the initial state, but final state becomes something like this. So let's draw the final state. These are thermally isolated walls. Okay. You just press thermally isolated walls. Okay. This is a porous plug. And this is a piston which is exactly pressed onto the porous plug so that there is no residual gas on the left hand side and all the gas has moved itself to the right hand side. Has been moved to the right hand side. Dots and the pressure in this section is PF and volume of this section is VF. So this is how the whole process took place. You just moved to both of the pistons with different velocity so that at every instance the pressure in this section is PF, at every instance the pressure in the leftward section was PI, but in the end this is another equilibrium condition, and in this equilibrium condition now you have the quantity is defined. Pressure is PF and volume is VF of this side. So this is the final equilibrium state. So this is how you do this. This whole process is known as throttling process or Joule-Thomson expansion or Joule-Kelvin expansion or porous plug process. So there are a few names of it. So this is either known as Joule-Thomson expansion or throttling process or porous plug expansion or Joule-Kelvin expansion as well, because this Lord Thomson, the William Thomson was later known as Lord Kelvin. So you can read this in your book. So that's why it is also known as Joule-Kelvin expansion, but we are not interested in the name. We are actually learning right now that why are we studying enthalpy at the first place? What does it physically mean? So let's analyze this process. So this process is irreversible in nature. So Joule-Thomson expansion, I will write it in initials as JTE. So Joule-Thomson expansion is irreversible process. Why? Because it is irreversible because Joule-Thomson expansion is irreversible because of something. What? Okay, somebody else came. Yes. So Joule-Thomson expansion is irreversible because what you have is actually when the gas flows from the porous plug to the other side due to friction between gas molecules and between gas molecules and the walls of the porous plug. There is some dissipation of some heat in this wall of the porous plug. So because of that, this process is irreversible, because you dissipate some energy as you move the gas, whole container of gas, from one side to the other side. So there is some dissipation of energy in terms of heat, and that is due to friction. So this process is irreversible. You can't now push both of these pistons and move them with the same velocity so that the pressure in both the sections again become, in this rightward section, becomes zero and this section becomes PI. You can't have that. This process is irreversible because of this friction. And now, so this process, how can we write this process down? So this process, you can say that equilibrium state PIVI initially. Now, after that equilibrium state, there were many small dissipative non-equilibrium states. And then after those many dissipative non-equilibrium states, you again have an equilibrium state. With the pressure and volume PF here. So how does this happen? Let me just again tell you this, that you are pushing both the pistons together and you have, initially you had an equilibrium state. Now, because of the friction between the gas molecules and the walls of the porous plug, some amount of heat is lost. So those states where these pistons are moving in that span, these states are not in equilibrium. They are dissipative. They are not in equilibrium. You can't define volume on both the sides because these guys are moving, both the pistons are moving continuously. They are dissipative non-equilibrium states, and in the end again you have an equilibrium state. So this is a throttling process, and this non-equilibrium states, as we all know, that we can only define equilibrium states with our thermodynamic variable PIVI and PFVI. There is no meaning of pressure, as in let us say if you have a box and you have a box of gas, and then you just open this side, if you open this side, just open this wall again, and then you can't define what is the pressure in this region immediately, because this gas has not come out. You cannot have a specific value of pressure at this point. So you have to give it some time, let gas completely spread out in this whole room, and then you can define the pressure at this point after the equilibrium. You cannot define any thermodynamic state variables like pressure, volume, when there is no equilibrium state. Thermodynamic state variables are defined only for equilibrium states, not for unequilibrium states, non-equilibrium states. So you cannot define pressure in these kind of problems. So dissipative non-equilibrium states also, you cannot have any thermodynamic variables which can describe these states. So these states cannot be described by thermodynamic variables. Thermodynamic state variables, I should say. You cannot have that description with thermodynamic state variables. Now, if you have any doubts till this point, just kindly ask. This is just simple. Now, actually, the understanding starts now. But I just wanted to know that, I just wanted to tell you that how this Joule-Thomson expansion looks like. It is this. Okay. Anybody has any doubts till this point? Okay. So in the mean states, you do not have any values of any thermodynamic variables. In the initial and final state also, you do not have any knowledge of temperature. You don't know what was the initial temperature, what was the final temperature. It is definitely different because of this dissipation of heat. The temperature is definitely different in the initial state and final state, but you do not have an exact idea of how much was the temperature initially and how much is the temperature finally. You do not have that exact idea. So let us talk about the initial and final values first of pressure and volume and temperature we don't know about. So let's talk about initial and final states. So in initial state and final state. In initial state, the pressure was PI, final state, the pressure was PF. So they both are definitely not equal. They both are not equal, initial pressure and final pressure. Initial state, the volume was VI, final state was volume was VF. They both are not equal. Okay, so initial state, the energy, internal energy was UI, let's say, and the final state, the internal energy is UF. And since both the temperatures are different, this internal energies are not same initial and final because there was some dissipation in between. So because of that dissipation, the internal energy definitely changed. So these things are not equal. PF, BI, UI, all those things, pressure, volume, and internal energies in initial states are not equal to their respective values in the final state. But there is a quantity which is equal in that initial state and final state. So which is both of these values are equal. We can't define that quantity in the mean states, but there is one quantity which is constant and not constant, but its initial value and final value are equal. Values are equal. So which is that quantity? We want to investigate that. That is our purpose now. Because we want to, okay, what is our purpose in the whole thermodynamics as a subject? Our purpose is to define any state, any system with proper state variables. That is our purpose in thermodynamics. अगर हमें थर्मोडाइनेमिक्स में इस पूरे सिस्टम को स्टेट वेरिएबल में रिप्रेजेंट करना आ गया, सो वी नो इट्स स्टेट, एंड इफ वी नो इट्स स्टेट, हमें उस सिस्टम के बारे में सब कुछ पता है जो हमें पता होना चाहिए. ओके, सो वी वांट टू नो प्रॉपर थर्मोडाइनेमिक वेरिएबल्स विच कैन डिस्क्राइब दीज स्टेट्स. नाउ अगर हमें थोड़ा और अच्छा लगे, सो वी डिफाइंड समथिंग कॉल्ड आइसोथर्मल प्रोसेसेस, कि जिसमें इनिशियल स्टेट और फाइनल स्टेट में टेम्परेचर सेम रहता है. वी डिफाइंड समथिंग कॉल्ड आइसोबारिक प्रोसेसेस, जिसमें इनिशियल और फाइनल स्टेट में प्रेशर सेम रहता है. आइसोकोरिक प्रोसेसेस इन विच द वॉल्यूम रिमेन्स द सेम. देर आर मेनी आइसोबारिक एडियाबेटिक प्रोसेसेस वेर द हीट रिमेन्स द सेम इन इनिशियल एंड फाइनल स्टेट्स. दीज आर अवर वेज ऑफ डिफाइनिंग और अवर वेज ऑफ डिस्क्राइबिंग द स्टेट ऑफ द सिस्टम. मतलब अगर हमें स्टेट ऑफ द सिस्टम पता होगा, ये सब चीजें अगर हमें पता हो कि भाई एक ऐसा प्रोसेस है जिसमें प्रेशर शुरुआत में था, जो था वही एंड में है, तो इट बिकम्स वेरी इजी फॉर अस टू एनालाइज दैट सिस्टम और एनालाइज दैट प्रोसेस. सो दैट इज वॉट अवर प्राइमरी पर्पज, कि हमें ऐसा कोई स्टेट वेरिएबल निकालना है जो इनिशियली और फाइनली सेम हो. देन अवर अंडरस्टैंडिंग इन दोज एरियाज और दोज काइंड ऑफ सिस्टम्स इन विथ रिस्पेक्ट ऑफ थर्मोडाइनमिक्स इंक्रीजेस. वही हमारा पर्पज है, कि हमारा थर्मोडाइनमिक्स से जो हम सिस्टम को एक्सप्लेन कर पाएंगे वो थोड़ा इंक्रीज हो जाए हमारा अंडरस्टैंडिंग ओवर दैट सिस्टम. सो दीज पैरामीटर्स आर नॉट कॉन्स्टेंट इन इनिशियल एंड फाइनल स्टेट. सो देर इज देर समथिंग विच इज कॉन्स्टेंट, दैट इज अवर क्वेश्चन. अगर ऐसा कुछ मिल जाता है तो क्या फायदा है? फायदा यह है कि ऐसा कुछ भी मिल गया हमें, तो दैट क्वांटिटी कैन डिस्क्राइब दीज काइंड ऑफ थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेसेस. वो क्वांटिटी ही थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेस को डिस्क्राइब करेगी. फिर हमें ये सब वेरिएबल्स पे ध्यान नहीं देना है, फिर वही क्वांटिटी पे ध्यान देना. सो दिस इज अवर बिग पिक्चर ऑफ थर्मोडाइनमिक्स. दिस इज वॉट वी वॉन्ट टू डू, टू फाइंड सम स्टेट वेरिएबल डूइंग दिस. सो लेट्स डू सम मैथमेटिक्स. सो दिस इज let's talk about initial. We are talking about initial and final state. So in initial and final state, this delta U can be given as delta Q minus delta W. This is the first law of thermodynamics. What is delta Q? Delta Q is heat given to the system. And delta W is work done by the system. This is the first law of thermodynamics. When I was a student, I found it really difficult to catch this first law of thermodynamics. This, but it is really easy if you see. You just keep a box of gas here with a piston. If you keep a box of gas with a piston, now if you supply some heat, if you put this box of gas on a stove, its internal energy will increase. It's what is in, its internal energy? It is the kinetic energy of all the molecules. It will increase if you put it on a stove. Its internal energy will increase. So by putting it on a stove, what you did, you gave heat to the system. So its internal energy will increase if you give the heat to the system. Now, how will its internal energy can decrease? How can it decrease? If this piston, which is on the top of this, if it moves upwards, then there is more place for these gas molecules to roam around, and its internal energy will decrease eventually. So if system does the work, it pushes the piston upwards. System does the work, then internal energy will decrease. That's why this negative sign. And if this heat given to the system, if we give the heat to the system, the internal energy will increase. So this is how we imagine the first law. Any questions? Somebody's mic is on. Can you turn it off? Okay. Okay. So this is delta U equal to delta Q minus delta W. Okay. So in this process, this our throttling process. For throttling process, let us apply this first law of thermodynamics. So for throttling process, it was adiabatic process. It was done in that adiabatic enclosure where no heat was allowed from the outside, no heat went to the outside. So it is the process was done in adiabatic enclosure. So delta Q is zero. And what is delta W? Delta W is the amount of work done. How do you describe it? It is initially the first side, the left side was at volume VI, and eventually came to the final volume zero. The piston was pushed, and in the same time at the constant pressure PI, the volume was changed. So this is the amount of work done on the left side plus the amount of work done on the right side. Initially its volume was zero, then its volume was VF. The pressure was constant in the whole volume PF, and we changed the volume. So this is how we define the work done. This is the work done on the system. This is the work done on the system. Okay. So this is the work done on the system. How do you write it? PIVI minus PFVF. If you can see this, equal to minus of PFVF minus PIVI. Oh, no, this is not correct. I am sorry. This is the correct. Right. Yes, so it is PFVF minus PIVI. So this is the work done on the system. So generally what you want is work done by the system. What you really want is work done by the system. So it is just the negative value of this. Work done by the system is negative value of this. Therefore, delta U is minus delta W. You have delta U, since delta Q is zero, delta U is minus delta W, and minus delta W is minus of PFVF minus PIVI. And what is delta U? It is the final internal energy minus initial internal energy of in the process. Therefore, UF plus PFVF is equal to UI. If you take this UI on this side and minus, if you multiply in the inside, it's plus PIVI. This is both the things. Now, what we came to realize, UF is not constant. Initial and final values are not equal. PF initial and final values are not equal. VF initial and final values are not equal. But this sum is equal in its final values and in initial values. So U plus PV is constant in this process for throttling process. Throttling process or Joule-Thomson expansion, anything. So U plus PV is constant in throttling process, and therefore we defined H as U plus PV. So HI equal to HF. This is not actually constant. I should not write it as constant, but U plus PV is equal in initial state is equal to its final state. So this is how I write it. U plus PV in initial state is equal to U plus PV in final state for throttling process. And that's why HI is equal to HF in throttling process. Simple mathematics was there, but we came to realize after this much mathematics that there is one quantity which is a state variable. Why? Because it is just multiplication and addition of three state variables. This is also a state variable, and this quantity, which is a state variable, is its value before the process. Initial value is equal to the final value just after the process. So in throttling process, the value of enthalpy, initial value of enthalpy and final values of enthalpy are equal. But here we should not misguide ourselves or misdirect ourselves in saying that H is constant. If you think that H is constant, it is not a proper way. H is not constant because in those mean stages where there are dissipative non-equilibrium states, you don't know what H is. In dissipative non-equilibrium states, we don't know H. We don't know that what is H. So H is not constant, but initial and final values of H are equal. So H is not constant in throttling process, but its initial and final values are equal. This is a very important point, by the way, for the enthalpy, because generally जब भी हमें पता चलता है कि एनर्जी इनिशियली और एनर्जी फाइनली इन अवर मैकेनिक्स, हमें ऐसा कुछ दिखता है कि एनर्जी इनिशियल और एनर्जी फाइनल इक्वल है, तो वी टेंड टू थिंक कि भाई एनर्जी इज कंजर्व, बट हियर एंथैल्पी इज नॉट कंजर्व, बिकॉज हमें पता ही नहीं कि बीच के स्टेट में एंथैल्पी का वैल्यू क्या है, बिकॉज बीच के जो स्टेट है वो इक्विलिब्रियम स्टेट ही नहीं है, तो वहां पे इक्विलिब्रियम स्टेट वेरिएबल के डेफिनेशन का कोई मतलब नहीं है, देयर इज नो मीनिंग ऑफ दीज काइंड ऑफ डेफिनेशंस। ओके, सो एच इज नॉट कॉन्स्टेंट इन डिसिपेटिव नॉन इक्विलिब्रियम स्टेट्स, वी डोंट नो वॉट एच इज, सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट पार्ट ऑफ एंथैल्पी। ओके, सो दिस इज द फर्स्ट प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ एंथैल्पी दैट फिजिकली दैट एंथैल्पी इज कॉन्स्टेंट इन थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेस। अच्छा, इंटरनल एनर्जी कौन सी प्रोसेस में कॉन्स्टेंट रहता है? इंटरनल एनर्जी, फॉर इंटरनल एनर्जी लेट मी राइट इट विद द ब्लैक पेन, फॉर यू यू आई इक्वल टू यू एफ इन विच काइंड ऑफ प्रोसेसेस, इन आइसोथर्मल प्रोसेसेस, बिकॉज फॉर नॉन इंटरेक्टिंग पार्टिकल्स, फॉर नॉन इंटरेक्टिंग पार्टिकल्स दिस इंटरनल एनर्जी इज डायरेक्टली डिपेंडिंग ऑन टेम्परेचर, इंटरनल एनर्जी मीन्स टेम्परेचर, सो इन आइसोथर्मल प्रोसेसेस द टेम्परेचर विल नॉट चेंज, सो इंटरनल एनर्जी विल नॉट चेंज, सो यू आई इक्वल टू यू एफ इन आइसोथर्मल प्रोसेसेस, बट एच आई इक्वल टू एच एफ इन थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेसेस। तो जब भी हमें आइसोथर्मल प्रोसेसेस दिखे, हमारा ध्यान जाना चाहिए कि भाई लेट्स कैन वी डू समथिंग विद दिस इंटरनल एनर्जी, एंड जब भी हमें थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेसेस दिखे, हमारा ध्यान जाना चाहिए कि कैन वी डू समथिंग विद दिस एंथैल्पी, द कांसेप्ट ऑफ एंथैल्पी। सो दिस इज हाउ यू शुड अटैक दोस प्रॉब्लम्स व्हिच विल कम इन योर रियल लाइफ। अगर आप रियल लाइफ में कोई रूम टेम्परेचर पे कोई लेबोरेटरी केमिस्ट्री लेबोरेटरी में कोई एक्सपेरिमेंट कर रहे हो, तो द थिंग विच विल बी कॉन्स्टेंट इज गोइंग टू बी यू आई इक्वल टू यू एफ, बट इफ यू आर एन इंजीनियर, विच नन ऑफ यू आर राइट नाउ, बट इफ सम ऑफ यू गो एंड डू सम एक्सपेरिमेंटल रिसर्च वेयर इंजीनियरिंग एस्पेक्ट इज ऑल्सो रिक्वायर्ड, इन दोज केसेस इफ यू आर इंजीनियर यू आर फ्लोइंग सम फ्लूइड फ्रॉम द हायर प्रेशर टू द लोअर प्रेशर, यू नीड टू टॉक अबाउट एंथैल्पी, यू नीड टू टॉक अबाउट एंथैल्पी, वील टॉक अबाउट दैट। सो इन दोज केसेस द एंथैल्पी इज द पार्ट विच यू नीड टू टेक इन माइंड, इन आइसोथर्मल प्रोसेस यू आई इक्वल टू यू एफ, बट इन दीज काइंड ऑफ थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेसेस एच आई इक्वल टू एच आई। सो दिस वॉज द फर्स्ट प्रॉपर्टी इज इन योर बुक दे आर राइटिंग दैट we are understanding the properties of enthalpy, but in my perspective we are understanding the physics of enthalpy, this is the physics of the enthalpy, that in throttling processes the enthalpy initial value and final values are equal, just like the internal energy, this is the enthalpy, but still its physical meaning is not there. Okay, so still its physical meaning is not there, so let's jump on to the physical meaning of this. So for physical meaning of this we need to go no further and just look back onto the first definition of enthalpy. So it was defined as U plus PV. So what you can define a small differential change in enthalpy as small differential change in U plus PV plus VdP, and this is equal to U plus PdV is how much? It is TdS and plus VdP. So this is the small change in enthalpy. This TdS is nothing but a small change in heat, TQ plus VdP. Can anybody of you tell me why I put a small hat here? You actually use this hat in your CI1 course as well. So why I put a small cross on the D as with Q? I did not use it with anybody else. I used it with Q. DH I can write it as DQ plus VdP, where I used the fact that DQ is TdS. Can anybody of you tell me why I did this?
For irreversible processes, we are showing this.
Yes, definitely. So this is not for irreversible processes. One answer is good, but yes, this is a one case of the bigger picture. For irreversible process, we are writing like this. But this is just to define that Q is not an exact differential. वी स्टडीड सम कंडीशन ऑफ एग्जैक्ट डिफरेंशियल्स, हमने जो पढ़ा था उधर की डेल एम बाई डेल एक्स इक्वल टू डेल एन बाई डेल वाई और समथिंग द अदर वे, आई डोंट नो विच वॉज इट वॉज समथिंग लाइक दिस, आई थिंक इट वॉज समथिंग लाइक दिस, दिस इज द कंडीशन फॉर एग्जैक्ट डिफरेंशिएशन और एनीथिंग, बट दिस इज अवर वे, अवर फिजिसिस्ट वे टू टेल दैट क्यू इज पाथ डिपेंडेंट। सो इफ यू टेक टॉक अबाउट द स्मॉल चेंज इन क्यू, you have to define on which path you are talking about. So this is why we write this bar to tell you that q is not a state variable. So agar aapko q mein change karna hai, that is path dependent. You cannot talk about ki bhai ye state se ye state mein gaya to q ka change itna hi hai. You cannot talk about that because q is not a state variable. The change in q depends on the path that you take. So this is there to show you that q is not an exact differential. But yes, in irreversible processes, that is what we want to tell you. That is the other way of showing that q is not a state variable, that it is in irreversible processes, the delta q is not zero. That is what we want to show you by this. So if you write dq is not equal to zero in irreversible processes, in reversible processes as well, this is not zero. In reversible processes as well. मतलब अगर आप एक स्टेट से निकल के पूरा चक्कर घूम के यहाँ वापस आए, सो प्रेशर इफ यू टॉक अबाउट पीवी डायग्राम, इफ यू टॉक अबाउट पीवी डायग्राम, एवरी पॉइंट ऑन द पीवी डायग्राम रिप्रेजेंट्स अ स्टेट ऑफ द सिस्टम. सो इफ यू केम एंड टुक अ राउंड टर्न एंड केम बैक एट द सेम पोजिशन, स्टिल द हीट डी क्यू इज नॉट गोइंग टू बी जीरो, स्टिल देयर विल बी सम हीट एंड द सिस्टम मस्ट हैव डन सम वर्क, बट यू डेल्टा यू इज जीरो. Delta P is zero, delta V is zero, everything is zero, but Q is not a state variable. So dQ is not even zero for reversible processes. For reversible processes as well, if you come back to the same point, still dQ is not going to be zero. So this is our way of saying that Q is not an exact differentials. So those quantities which depend on the path taken, they are not exact differentials in mathematical languages. So aapne agar देखा हो तो द कंजर्वेटिव फोर्सेस एंड नॉन कंजर्वेटिव फोर्सेस यू मस्ट हैव स्टडीड इन योर मैकेनिक्स. सो नॉन कंजर्वेटिव फोर्सेस आर नॉट एग्जैक्ट डिफरेंशियल्स एंड क्यू इज काइंड ऑफ नॉन कंजर्वेटिव फोर्स. सो इट डिपेंड्स ऑन द पाथ यू टेक, जस्ट लाइक फ्रिक्शन. सो दैट्स व्हाई फ्रिक्शन इज हीट, नथिंग एल्स. सो क्यू इज अ नॉन कंजर्वेटिव फोर्स. ओके, सो हियर डीएच इज रिटन एज डी क्यू प्लस वीडीपी. आई रोट दीज थिंग्स फॉर समथिंग कॉल्ड, ओके, आई रोट दीज थिंग्स for something called quasi-static processes. I wrote these, the small change in H for quasi-static process. For quasi, what do I mean by quasi-static process? If you have a gas container and you have a piston, there is some gas in here. Now, if you just abruptly move this piston up, the next state is going to be like this. And for some time, the system will not be in equilibrium. So you do not have the values of pressure and volume of this section, or pressure you do not have at every instance. Okay, you cannot define pressure at every instance. But if you do this very, very slowly, and if you do this in such a way, you have thoda sa piston uthaya, and you give some time to the system to actually equilibrium, to get in equilibrium, then again you lifted the piston by some small amount. Again, you lifted the piston by small amount, and just every time you are giving the system time to actually come back to the state of equilibrium, every time you are giving it the time, so this process becomes a static process for a small changes. That's why it is not actually a static process, but it looks like a static process. That's why we call it quasi-static process. In each and every state, in each and every stage, जो आप पिस्टन थोड़ा 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 उठाओगे, इनफाइनाइटेसिमली स्मॉल उठाओगे, और हर बार आप सिस्टम को टाइम दोगे, अब आप इक्विलिब्रियम में आ जाओ, फिर हम प्रेशर मेजर करेंगे, वॉल्यूम मेजर करेंगे, फिर थोड़ा सा उठाएंगे, फिर इक्विलिब्रियम में आने देंगे, फिर प्रेशर वॉल्यूम. सो दिस प्रोसेस विच इज डन इन दिस स्लो मैनर इज नोन एज क्वासी स्टेटिक प्रोसेस. ओके, सो इन एनी क्वासी स्टेटिक प्रोसेस आई वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट द चेंज इन एच, एंड दैट चेंज इन एच आई गॉट इट फ्रॉम एज डी क्यू प्लस वी डी पी. ओके, सो नाउ लेट्स डिवाइड बाई टी on both the sides. Don't do it in front of mathematics students, but I am just telling you, just divide by dt. Don't do it in front of mathematics students, they will not like it. They never divide it by dt. This is not the correct way of doing mathematics, but we physicists often find it okay to do so. So let's divide it by dt, v dp by dt. And this, if we talk about this process at constant pressure, at constant pressure, that means for isobaric processes, this dp is going to be zero. This is going to be zero. So this whole term will going to be is going to be zero, and this only the part which remains is dh by dt, at constant pressure equal to dq by dt at constant pressure. And now anybody of you can tell me what is dq by dt at constant pressure? It is the specific heat at constant pressure. Sorry, it is not specific heat, it is the heat capacity at constant pressure. So it is known as isobaric heat capacity. The amount of heat needed to change the temperature by 1 degree or 1 Kelvin is isobaric heat capacity at constant pressure. So this is isobaric heat capacity. This is the another property of enthalpy. You can derive some beautiful conclusions from here. From this equation, you can derive some beautiful conclusions. First conclusion is that H is related with Cp in some way or the other, with Cp in some way or the other. You just can integrate both the sides and you can get the relation between H and Cp. Okay, I should write here del. It should not be dH by dt, it is del H by del t, because we are talking about constant pressure. So it should be del H by del t. H is related with Cp in some way or the other. We will probe this relation in the next 2 minutes. But there is another thing, that H is a function of pressure and temperature. H is a function of pressure and temperature in practical sense. Why I wrote it practical sense? Whenever you are doing the experiments in the laboratory, you generally take H to be the function of pressure and temperature. But in our characteristic function, when we defined the the characteristic variables of the H was the function of entropy and volume. No, it is entropy and pressure, sorry. So entropy and pressure, we defined it H to be the characteristic function of entropy and pressure. But in practical, if you see this relation, in practicality, if you see in this relation for quasi-static process, this H has to be function of temperature and pressure only, because if there were some other variables associated with this H, then there would have been some other terms added to the Cp. क्योंकि आप जब डिफरेंशिएट करते हो तो कुछ और टर्म्स भी आ जाते हैं जब आप टी के रिस्पेक्ट में डिफरेंशिएट कर रहे हो और पी को कांस्टेंट कर रहे हो. अगर ये एच टी और पी के अलावा किसी भी वेरिएबल पे डिपेंड करता देन यू मस्ट हैव गॉट सम अदर एडिटिव टर्म्स इन द सीपी बट यू डू नॉट गॉट दोस टर्म्स. सो एच इज अ फंक्शन ऑफ पी एंड टी इन प्रैक्टिकल सेंस. बट इन थियरी स्टिल वी यूज दैट एच इज अ कैरेक्टरिस्टिक फंक्शन ऑफ एस एंड वी. बट इन लेबोरेटरी वी समटाइम्स यूज दैट पी इज एच इज अ फंक्शन ऑफ पी एंड टी. But the problem with thermodynamics is you do not use it daily in your laboratory. So these things are really tricky to catch at the first sight, but you will get acquainted with these parts as you use them again and again in your theoretical calculations. You will get acquainted with these parts. So this H is a function of P and T in practical sense, because in laboratory you will use that. Otherwise, some other terms would have been there. Okay. This is the property number three, and let's derive H. So you can derive H from this relation. This just multiply T on the other side and just take integration to find H. So therefore, change in H means final value of H minus initial value of H is equal to Cp dt from initial to final state. And this is true for any quasi-static process. Any quasi-static process. This is true for any quasi-static process. Okay, so H PET in practical sense, and this is how you define the change in enthalpy in any quasi-static process. Now, this UI equal to UF, but in any quasi-static process, how do you define the change in internal energy? UI minus UF, how do you define this? Okay, how do you define this change in internal energy for any quasi-static process? You can think about it and let me know right now. UI minus UF, it is Cv dt for initial final state for any quasi-static process. I hope you know this. How many of you don't know this? Just raise your hand. How did I wrote this? Okay, only one guy doesn't know. Then it is good. Okay, two. Okay, so how did I wrote this? For internal energy, you know this first law of thermodynamics. It is dq minus dw. or it is dq minus p dv. So if you divide it with dp, dt, sorry, again, so du by dt equal to dq by dt. And now if you take this at constant volume, then these both are equal, and dq by dt at constant volume is equal to c. So from this you can get this result, du by dt del u by dt should be at constant V is CV, so you just can integrate that. So for any quasi-static process, the change in internal energy is defined like this, but change in enthalpy is defined like this. I am comparing both of these just to get the idea that they are very symmetric in a manner. They are very, very symmetric. Okay, so for I just talked about when this U was initial value and final value of U was equal. And in this case, the initial and final value of enthalpy is equal. So for different processes, different things happen. So I just want to know, I just want to tell you actually, ki hum alag alag processes mein alag alag cheeze use karenge. So for any quasi-static processes, if you want to find out the change in U, you will use this equation. This equation is easy to use when the process is happening at constant volume. But if the process is happening at constant pressure, it means in room temperature, so chemistry wale laboratory mein experiment karenge, it is happening at constant pressure in room, at room. So us case mein agar aapko change nikalna hai, so it is better to find out the change in enthalpy rather than to find out the change in internal energy. So in the phase transition and all those things, you actually find the change in enthalpy. Jab phase transition karte ho, phase transition hota hai to kya hota hai, the you have a liquid or patile ke andar pani liya, usko aapne garam kiya, if you gave it some heat, then it will become vapor. और वो जब वेपर बन रहा होगा क्या होगा, एक बार ये टेम्परेचर 100 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड पहुंच गया, उसके बाद यू हैव टू वेट फॉर सम टाइम जब पूरा का पूरा पानी वेपर बन जाएगा, और फिर वो अगर आपने बंद किया हुआ है तो और टेम्परेचर बढ़ेगा, अदरवाइज वो उड़ जाएगा. तब तक इस पानी का टेम्परेचर 100 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड ही रहेगा जब तक पूरा का पूरा पानी वेपर बन गया. तो टेम्परेचर नहीं बढ़ रहा है, तो वेयर द हीट इज गोइंग, हीट इज गोइंग टू चेंज द फेज, to change the phase, and that is known as latent heat, but actual term is latent enthalpy, because us time pe aap khule ke andar experiment kar rahe ho, khule environment mein, so the environmental pressure is constant, so actual term is, in that case jo latent heat hai usko latent enthalpy bolna chahiye. Actually what you are going to measure there is latent enthalpy, not latent heat. Okay, so at in constant pressure you are changing the temp, you are not sensing any change in temperature, so what you are, how are you getting the change in heat, जो आपको फेज ट्रांसफॉर्म करने के लिए चाहिए. आप स्टव चालू का चालू ही रखते हो तभी फेज ट्रांसफॉर्म होता है, बंद कर देते हो तो नहीं होता. इट मींस यू हैव टू कांस्टेंटली प्रोवाइड हीट टू चेंज दैट फेज, एंड दैट इज नोन एज लेटेंट हीट, बट एक्चुअल टर्म शुड बी लेटेंट एंथैल्पी, नॉट द लेटेंट हीट. ओके, सो दैट्स वेयर यू आर गिविंग एंथैल्पी टू द सिस्टम. सो एंथैल्पी इज ऑल्सो अ फॉर्म ऑफ एनर्जी, यू कैन टॉक अबाउट दैट इन दैट मैनर. सो फिजिकल मीनिंग यू आर, आई नो दैट अब हम थोड़ा थोड़ा पास जा रहे हैं फिजिकल मीनिंग के, दीज वेर द मैथमेटिकल मीनिंग्स एंड मैथमेटिकल प्रॉपर्टीज, अब हम बहुत ही पास जा रहे हैं फिजिकल मीनिंग के, कि एक्चुअल फिजिकल मीनिंग क्या हो रहा होगा. ओके, बट लेट्स टेक वन एग्जाम्पल बिफोर दैट फिजिकल मीनिंग. वन एग्जाम्पल, वी नो दैट एच एफ माइनस एच आई इज इक्वल टू इंटीग्रेशन इन इनिशियल टू फाइनल स्टेज सी पी डी टी. सो नाउ आई वॉन्ट टू फाइंड आउट फॉर आइडियल गैस, the cp is equal to 5 by 2 r. if I assume that all of you know this value, for ideal gas cp is 5 by 2 r. That's why hf minus hi is equal to 5 by 2 r, and you just have to take the integration of dt, which is t, and you have to put the limits in. So this is tf minus ti for hf. This is the value of hf for ideal gas. Now one can do the experiments in the laboratory, one knows the initial temperature of the ideal gas, final temperature of the ideal gas, you can know how much heat got transferred in the ideal gas in that span, and that heat is nothing but this change in enthalpy. You know the change in temperature, you can know the change in enthalpy for ideal gas. This is one way. Okay, this is just the example to tell you ki hum change in enthalpy nikal sakte if you know the Cp. For different substances CP differs, some substances CP also depends on the temperature. You will learn in solid state physics that CP also depends on the temperature. You will learn something called Debye model and Einstein model. Their theory of specific heat tells you that for some low temperatures the specific heat depends on the temperature in some way, some form or the other. So you will learn that in your solid state physics. In those cases, still you will be able to find the HF minus HI because you know the functional dependence of CP and CV onto the temperature. So you know this. Okay. Now let's go for the property number three. We know that DH. Okay. Let me just change the color of the pen so we can distinguish. Okay. So we know that DH is change in dQ plus VdP. Therefore, for isobaric processes directly from here, what for isobaric processes, dH is equal to dQ. And this is the most wonderful physical explanation of enthalpy. So for isobaric processes, dP is going to be zero. And that's why dH is equal to dQ. Iska matlab hai ki koi bhi isobaric process hogi is nature mein. वो आइसोबारिक प्रोसेस में जो भी हीट आप सिस्टम को सप्लाई कर रहे हो या सिस्टम से एक्सट्रैक्ट कर रहे हो दैट इज नथिंग बट द एंथैल्पी दैट इज एंथैल्पी सो दिस इज द मोस्ट एज क्लोज टू द फिजिकल मीनिंग एज वी कैन गेट दिस इज द फिजिकल मीनिंग ऑफ एंथैल्पी दैट इन एन आइसोबारिक प्रोसेस कोई भी प्रोसेस हो रहा है नेचर में रेंडमली बहुत सारे प्रोसेस होते हैं इफ यू गो एंड फाइंड आउट इफ द प्रोसेस इज आइसोबारिक और नॉट और इन योर लेबोरेटरी इफ यू फाइंड अ वे टू actually do the isobaric process in your laboratory at some constant pressure, in that case, whatever the heat you transfer to the system, it is enthalpy, nothing else. So in isobaric process, the change in enthalpy is equal to heat supplied to the system. It is equal to the heat supplied to the system. This is for isobaric process and this is the physical meaning of enthalpy. Okay, what is enthalpy? Ab aapko koi bole jaise internal energy ka aapko ek intuition hota hai. What is internal energy? It is related to temperature. Internal energy matlab kinetic energy or potential energy of each and every particles. Jo andar ka internal andar ki unke internal degrees of freedom ki wajah se hai. Internal degrees of freedom matlab internal kinetic energy, internal potential energy ki wajah se jo total energy hai us system ka use internal energy kahenge. Waise hi aap system ko isobaric process ke andar jitna bhi heat dete ho wo uska enthalpy. This is the enthalpy. Okay, so this is how you define enthalpy. This is the best physical meaning of the enthalpy. Best how close how can you get? This is as close as you can get. This is the physical meaning of the enthalpy. Now this was something. Now let's go and find out something more about the enthalpy. So dH is dQ plus VdP. Now for adiabatic processes, you have dQ equal to zero. There is no heat entered into the system. There is no heat inserted into the system, no heat extracted from the system. So this dQ is zero, and therefore you can have dH equal to VdP. And therefore, if you want to find out actually HF minus HI, the change in the enthalpy in that adiabatic process, it means initial value, final value, VdP. This is how you find it. This is correct for any adiabatic process. Okay, this is correct for any adiabatic process. Okay, this is HF minus HI for any adiabatic process. Now I want to actually tell you what does this physically mean. Let us understand this. This was some mathematics. Now let us understand this part physically. So what does this physically mean? So if you plot set of axes here, okay, you can plot a set of axes. Now you can talk about it is either it is a PV diagram, let's say, or wo PV diagram mein, in a quasi static process, if system goes from the one state initial state to the final state via this path, the system goes like this, then what is integration VdP? It is something like this. So this area under the curve is known as integration PdV. This area under the curve is known as integration PdV. But this area on the left side of the curve, let me write it in the black pen. This area, total area on the left side of the curve is known as integration VdP. This is the area which gives us the change in enthalpy, and it is known as, in engineering physics, it is known as the flow work, also known as flow work. This is also known as flow work. And what does it mean? कि आपके पास एक हायर प्रेशर रीजन है, वहां से आप लोअर प्रेशर रीजन में कुछ फ्लूइड को ट्रांसफर कर रहे हो. सो द एनर्जी गेन्ड बाय द फ्लूइड ड्यू टू प्रेशर डिफरेंस, ड्यू टू हाई प्रेशर, व्हेन इट टेक्स दैट एनर्जी फ्रॉम द हाई प्रेशर टू द लो प्रेशर, दैट इज नोन एज द चेंज इन एंथैल्पी. तो जो हमारा थ्रॉटलिंग प्रोसेस था उसमें भी एक प्रेशर से दूसरे प्रेशर में कुछ फ्लूइड फ्लो हो रहा था. तो जो एनर्जी सिस्टम यहां से यहां ट्रांसफर कर रहा था, बिकॉज बोथ ऑफ दोस प्रेशर्स एंड ड्यू टू द सिस्टम वाज दिस, देयर वाज सम डिसिपेशन एज वेल. तो हम इनिशियल और फाइनल प्रेशर के बारे में कोई कमेंट नहीं कर पा रहे थे प्रॉपरली. द प्रेशर वर देयर बट दे वर नॉट इक्वल. बट इन सम केसेस, जैसे कि आपके पास कोई ज्यादा प्रेशर से कम प्रेशर पे कुछ फ्लूइड फ्लो हो रहा है, जस्ट एज इन केस ऑफ अवर स्प्रे बॉटल, तो उस प्रोसेस में जो एनर्जी गेन किया है फ्लूइड ने, दैट इज नोन एज द एंथैल्पी ऑफ द स्प्रे कैन और समथिंग. सो दैट इज एनर्जी गेन, और इट इज ऑल्सो नोन एज फ्लो वर्क. सो दिस इज नोन एज द एंथैल्पी ऑफ द सिस्टम. नाउ इन योर बुक देर इज समथिंग गिवन, आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू जस्ट टेक यू थ्रू दैट पार्ट. देर इज अ टेबल विच इज गिवन इन योर बुक विच जस्ट टेल्स यू दैट हाउ यू कैन एक्चुअली सी द सिमिलैरिटीज बिटवीन इंटरनल एनर्जी एंड एंथैल्पी. दिस इज द सिमेट्रिक part of the thermodynamics. So for free expansion, which is also irreversible, ui equal to uf, and for throttling process, which is also irreversible, hi equal to hf. What is the free expansion? Agar aapke paas ek gas hai, gas ka container hai with some pressure p, volume v, what is the free expansion? You just take it into a vacuum and just open it, that is a free expansion. Uske samne koi aur gas molecules nahi hai usko force dene ke liye, that is the free expansion. उसके सामने कोई भी मॉलिक्यूल नहीं, जस्ट टेक इट टू वैक्यूम एंड ओपन इट, दैट इज द फ्री एक्सपांशन ऑफ द गैस. एंड इन दैट फ्री एक्सपांशन विच इज इररिवर्सिबल ऑफ कोर्स, यूआई इज इक्वल टू यूएफ. बट अगर कोई ये बॉक्स में आप इस बॉक्स को खोलोगे जिसमें ऑलरेडी कुछ गैस मॉलिक्यूल्स प्रेजेंट है, तो ये गैस मॉलिक्यूल्स इन गैस मॉलिक्यूल्स को बाहर निकलने के टाइम कुछ फोर्स देंगे, एंड दैट विल नॉट बी द फ्री एक्सपांशन. बट इन फ्री एक्सपांशन यू जस्ट टेक दिस टू वैक्यूम, दैट इज द फ्री एक्सपांशन. There is a more mathematical definition of free expansion. This is very important for those competitive exams because they ask you something like free expansion. So mathematical definition of free expansion is that in the process of expansion is dw is zero. If dq is zero, then du is also zero. This is known as the free expansion. If dw is zero and dq is zero, this is known as the free expansion. In irreversible processes, both of these, for different processes, different quantities are constant for initial and final values. In general, you can write du as this and dh as this. Isochoric processes, you can write uf minus ui equal to qv. Isobaric, hi minus h qp. All those things you can read for adiabatic, for ideal gas. You can just find out the similarities between enthalpy and internal energy using this table. And this is all the point is. आपको पता चले कि जैसे ये important है physics में, this is also an important part. Is also an important quantity because you can find out something like this. Okay, so this is the official ending of the lecture. If you have any questions, I'm sorry I forgot to give you the time to ask questions in this lecture, but if you have any questions, you can ask right now.